roads in our country, majority of the roads are the bituminous pavements, which we call as the flexural pavements. They are called as flexural because they deflect under the action of the traffic, and bituminous or blacktop pavements because they are made up of bitumen, and blacktop because the surface is black. So whatever nomenclature you use, but majority of our roads are bituminous pavements. More than 90% of the roads are the bituminous pavements in our country. Pavement is basically a smooth surface wherein the traffic moves in. So it is basically a structure which is not a random structure, but it is a very properly designed structure wherein you have different layers, one layer on the top of other, of good quality materials placed so that you have a smooth riding, a good quality surface on which the traffic can ply. So the different layers of the pavement are, the lowest layer is known as subgrade. On the top of it, we have sub-base layer, then we have a base course layer, then we have the surface layer, which is mostly the bituminous material. Now, if you look at the materials which are required to construct these different layers of a pavement, you require aggregates, and obviously we require the bitumen, which is used in the topmost layers of the bituminous pavement. Now, bitumen is less than 5% of the total material that is used in the entire pavement, but still it is a very important part because it provides the sealing and it also acts as a structural layer to the bituminous pavements. Now, for using these aggregates and bitumen, you'll obtain from the quarry, which are the sources for the aggregates, wherein the aggregates are quarried and they are used in the bituminous layers, in the different layers of the bituminous pavement, and the bitumen is obtained from the fractional distillation of the crude petroleum. Now, all these sources are very scarce, and these days the asphalt paving industry or the bituminous road construction industry is facing three big challenges. One of the challenges is these raw materials, they are depleting at a very fast rate. Give you some stats: for 1 kilometer of road construction, approximately 20,000 tons of good quality aggregates are required. And you think of the amount of construction that is currently going on, so you require lakhs of tons of good quality aggregates, which are becoming scarce day by day. And for a lead of almost 200 kilometers, which is very common in the northern side of the country, 180 lakh liters of diesel is used in the transportation of these good quality aggregates to the construction site, because the quarries might be available at far off locations. So for a lead of almost 200 kilometers, which is common, so you require this much quantity of diesel. So think of the amount of energy that we are consuming to construct these roads. Now, as per one of the reports which talks about the material consumption patterns in India, it says that by 2020, 2 billion tons of coarse aggregates are required, and by 2021, this requirement would grow to 10 billion. It will grow 5 times in a single year. So this is a huge quantity, and this much huge quantity, if we keep on quarrying our rocks and quarrying our mountains, there will be no mountains. This also says that the existing resources will last only for the next 25 to 30 years. So this means that after a period of 25 years, either we stop building our roads, or the other option can be we start looking for some other ways, some sustainable ways through which we can construct our pavements. We need to innovate. We need to improve our design methodologies. We need to innovate. We need to develop some new materials, new techniques through which we can keep on building our roads. The other issue is that there is a demand, or there is a growing concern about the environment, the damage that is caused to the environment because of the construction industry. And I must tell you, the construction sector is one of the largest emitters of greenhouse gases, CO2 polluters. So you need to start looking for good environment friendly paving mixtures which can be used and which are not detrimental to the environment. The third issue is because of the heavy overloading, there have been premature pavement failures. Because of the heavy overloading, we have not been able to control the overloading on the pavements. Pavements are designed for a standard load, but the loads that actually ply on the pavement are much higher than these loads. So these pavements are getting premature failures. The current binders are not able to cope up with the loading conditions. So you require improved binders, improved quality of materials, improved construction techniques. So the pace at which we are constructing our payments would require that we would necessitate that we need good or very large quantities of materials. So we cannot keep on just exploiting our Mother Earth, because all these materials we get from the Mother Earth. And Mahatma Gandhi once said that the earth provides enough to satisfy one's every man's needs. So needs can be satisfied, but not the greed. And we should not become greedy. So we need to think of alternative and sustainable ways through which we can continue with our road building program. And the problems that are because of this continuous or exorbitant use of our natural resources, it can be solved only when we look for new innovative ways and sustainable ways. So Albert Einstein also said that the world we have created today has problems which cannot be solved by thinking the way we thought when we created them. So you need to really think out of the box, think some good quality techniques, think some sustainable techniques so that we can keep on constructing our fields. There is an urgent need to move towards new and innovative materials so that you can actually have sustainable payments which will last longer and which are sustainable in the true sense also. Now, when we talk about sustainable as well payments, the word sustainable is a very catchy word. So I'll talk about a little bit about what basically sustainability means. Now, there is a report from the United Nations World Commission of Development and Environment, and what they define sustainability is that it is about meeting the needs of the present without compromising the ability of future generations to meet their own needs. This means the needs of the present should also be satisfied, and we should not also consume the material in such a way that for the future generations we do not leave anything. So one has to take care of the present scenario, also look into the needs of the future generations also. So this is what the concept of sustainability says. Sustainability, it brings three elements into harmony, which talks about the economy, society, and environment. And we talk about these one by one. First, let us take about the environmental considerations in the sense of a road engineer, or from the sense of pavement construction. The environmental considerations talk about the dwindling natural resources. Our natural resources are depleting at a very fast rate because of the pace of construction that we are embarking upon with the prestigious Government of India programs. We have to reduce the use of these natural resources, and we have to reuse or keep on reusing the waste material, try to maximize their use. We have to reduce the emissions and greenhouse gases effects, and also reduce the fossil fuel consumption. From the social point of view, the user delay, the congestion is one of the consideration. The ride quality, the comfort of the user, because nobody would like to travel on a bumpy road. We want very smooth highways. And at the time when we are paying a lot of tolls for traveling on these highways, I definitely want, or any user would want, a very good riding comfort. So the quality of highways should also be very good. And obviously the noise levels, they are also one of the social considerations. Now, from the point of view of economic considerations, if we can design payments which will last longer, they'll obviously, a longer lasting payment would cost you less amount of money. If you use the natural resources, less natural resources, it will also lead to cost reduction in the cost. Lower fuel usage will also lead to reduction in the cost. And smooth payments, if you have very smooth payments, then the operating cost, the vehicle operating cost would be reduced. And that is also one of the economic considerations. So we want that payment should be such that they encompass all these parameters of sustainability. And we should be able to have good quality payments. Now, when we construct any payment, or when we encounter a unsuitable construction condition, suppose there is a location where a payment or a road project is planned, but the construction conditions are not suitable, then I have four different options. The first option is I can remove the existing soil and replace it with a good quality material. Obviously, that would depend upon the availability of good quality material in the nearby region. Nobody would want to bring tons of material from a very far off distance and bring it to the project site. So that option might not be workable every time. Second option would be you can change the project location. You want to design a road at a particular location, you can change the project location. Then this is also not very viable option because changing the project location is not very sound engineering practice, because a project is designed based on the needs of the users. So if you change the project location, that would not be working a workable solution. You need to change the design. Change the design means if you have a weak material, then you need to improve the design. You need to provide a good, better or thicker pavement layers. That might be workable, but sometimes this will be uneconomical also because of the financial considerations, that you are using good quality material, you are improving, you are providing thick pavements, so that might be economically not viable. So the last option that is left is you improve the material properties and you innovate with some alternate design, wherein the design is such that it will provide you a very economical or cheaper solution, and you also use good quality materials. So that is one of the viable options that is most of the time resorted to when you have such difficult problems, where all other options fail and you are left with only this option to innovate and improve the material properties. Now we talk about some of the sustainable paving practices that are being adopted all over the world and in our country also. This list, I've listed here only five practices that I'll be discussing in the presentation today, but there is a long list of sustainable paving practices. This list is not intended to be exhaustive. There are many other technologies which have been used and they have been found to successful also, but I'll be discussing in this presentation only five of them. So the first one is the waste plastic road. If you talk about the current situation of waste plastic is something which we see in everyday life. So to give you a brief stats about the current situation of waste plastic, the global production of plastic is close to 400 million tons. And average world day utilization of plastic is almost 45 kgs per person. These figures are approximate and based on the available information on the internet and in the literature. And these many plastics, you have heard about the term like single use plastics. So the plastics are discarded after a very short life cycle, like you use it once, one or two times, and then you discard it. And approximately 3% of each plastic, each year's plastic waste, it ends up in the sea, thereby harming the environment and the wildlife and the marine life also. Safe disposal is again a very serious problem. It's known to everyone that plastic is causing a lot of hazard to our Mother Earth. So we need to think of ways where we can use this waste plastic. The other problem with the plastic is it is a non-biodegradable material, so it can sustain at least 1,000 years and it will not degrade. Dumping in landfills, open areas will also be a wasteful use of scarce land resources. So that option is also not available. So, and land pollution and disposal of these waste plastic is a challenge, but it can be reduced significantly if these materials are utilized in road construction. So road industry is one industry which can use this waste plastic. Now, how this waste plastic is used in the road, I'll discuss about that, but first we'll talk about the plastic waste generation. It is by the street side plastic litter. It can be from the plastic industry waste. It can be from the household plastics and sometimes the garbage by the rag pickers. Some of the photographs to show about the disposal issues, it is dumped in the drains, then it is segregated. These are the dumping issues. Dumping in the forest. Other issues like you have seen, this is a very common picture which we normally see in our community or in our everyday life, that plastic is littered on the roads and the cows or the cattle, they are feeding on them. Now the other issue is the plastic can also break into small particles which are known as microparticles or microplastics, which will go to the marine life or to the sea, and it can also enter the food chain and it can be harmful to the humans also. But the issue with waste plastic is not every type of waste plastic can be used in the road construction. As I told you, that the pavement is a designed structure. It is a properly designed structure. It is not that different layers are placed one on the top of the other. Each layer has to have certain important properties and parameters. So waste plastic can be used in the road construction, but there are certain types of waste plastic that can be used and certain categories of waste plastic that cannot be used. So here it shows the examples of plastic that can be used and examples of plastic which cannot be used, like flexible pouches, Ziploc pouches, heat sealed bags, they are recommended. And if you see like flexible labels of bottles, containers, which are mainly made up of PVC, they are not recommended. Black films are not recommended. Flexible carry bags, shopping bags, non-woven bags, trash bags can be used, but only if they are not in black in color, because black plastic indicates that it's a product of repeated recycling. So those repeated recycled products are not recommended to be used in the road construction. And similarly, PVC based plastic, they are also not recommended to be used in the road construction. What are the advantages of waste plastic? Obviously, when you add waste plastic to the road for the road construction, it results in different improvement of different properties, like it provides a higher resistance to deformation, it provides higher resistance to water-induced damages, it improves the fatigue life and the durability, it provides a better strength and stability, and it also environmentally friendly solution, because for one construction of 1 kilometer of road, approximately 3.5 tons of carbon credits can be saved when compared with the burning of waste plastics. So there is a lot of saving in the carbon credits also, and it also addresses the issue of safe disposal of waste plastic. Now, there are two methods of using waste plastic in the road construction industry. One is the dry method and one is the wet method. The dry method is wherein you heat the shredded waste plastic pieces are used for coating the aggregates. When they are heated, they'll melt and they'll coat the aggregates. And then when these coated aggregates are used in the bituminous mixes, they provide good properties of the pavement. They improve the fatigue life, they improve the rutting life, and all other properties improvement. The other option is the wet process, for which CRA has the patent. And obviously, once an organization is having a patent, that means that knowledge is not available in the open domain. So this knowledge of waste plastic in the wet process is available with CRA, and CRA has got three different patents. One is the wet process patent for polyethylene waste, wet process patent for thermocoal waste, and wet process patent for PVC waste. So three different pastes we have, and in the wet process, what it is done is the plastic is grounded and it is made into a powder, and that powder is mixed into the bitumen at a very at a high temperature of 160, 165 degrees centigrade, and high shear mixer is used to blend this waste plastic into the bitumen. And some chemical treatment is also done so that there is no phase separation of the polymer or the waste plastic from the bitumen. So I told you that wet process is a patented technology which is available with CRI. So the remaining, that is the dry process. Now, for this dry process, there is an IRC guideline also, which is IRCSP 98/2020, which is the latest guideline. The previous version was 2013, and now it has been revised. So this is the guidelines of the use of waste plastic in hot bituminous mixes. It specifically talks about the dry process in varying courses. As I told you, that not all waste plastic can be used, so certain specifications of waste plastic has to be maintained, and the code also suggests that it should conform to size passing 2.36 mm and should not be finer than 600 micron sieve. So it should retain on 600 micron sieve size. So size is 2.36 passing and 600 micron retain. Dust and other impurities should be less than 1%, and waste plastic should be added up to 6 to 8% of the weight of the bitumen that is used in the mix. So from 6 to 8% it can be used, which is close to 0.4 to 0.5% of the total weight of the bituminous mix. But still, there are certain concerns with the use of waste plastic. The toxicity and the other properties of the chemical additives that are used in the plastic, they are known. So they can be a very big environmental issue. So one has to take care of all those issues. Now, heating plastics can also release sometimes toxic emissions, so one has to be careful when preparing the bituminous mixes with waste plastic, because this can be a serious problem for the health and safety of the persons involved. As I told you, microplastics, it is flushed down into the rivers, lakes and seas, and it cause a major problem to the marine life, and it can also be a problem for the humans when we eat river fish or other seafood. And reuse of waste plastic modified mixes should also consider that what is the source of the material and how it can be used, by understanding what is the environmental risk and how you can manage these risks. CRI has laid certain trial sections. They have been used in numerous road construction in Delhi, and these are some of the pictures which indicate the roads which have been constructed with waste plastic, and these roads have been performing for the past 8-10 years, and they are in very good condition. So there's no issue with the use of waste plastic as such. So the second practice that I would like to talk about is the payment recycling. Now, recycling is a buzzword. Recycling means you have to recycle. Recycle is you have to use something again and again. So in the same idea can be applied to the road construction industry also, wherein you construct a pavement. Now, the common practice is once you construct a pavement and after it has gone through some years of deterioration, like it's been put into service for 8-10 years of life, the idea is to provide an overlay or to renew or provide a surface treatment on the existing bituminous pavement. So in this way, we are again keep on increasing a new layer to the existing bituminous layer without understanding that the existing pavement layer that is already there in the field that can also be removed and that can be used. So recycling is basically removing the existing bituminous layer or utilizing the materials in the existing pavement and then reusing them again. So the material that we get from the pavement when we mill it or when we scarify it, that is known as the RAP. RAP is the short term for reclaimed asphalt pavement, which is based which we obtain when we mill the old bituminous pavement, and it can be endogenous in nature if it is from a same pavement and it is recycled in situ, and exogenous when it is brought in from some other location. Now the question is why we should use RAP. So the answer is very simple, because it offers savings in materials cost, energy cost, and the total job cost when you are using the existing material. Now, the existing material will contain the aggregates and the bitumen also. Though the properties of bitumen being a viscoelastic material will be deteriorated or will not be as good as the original pavement, but we have techniques to restore their properties and we can use the RAP material. Aggregate is something which can be used in the payment. So utilizing this existing RAP material would be a very beneficial thing for the payment construction, wherein we are going to save a lot on the material cost. So additional benefit is that our natural resources are preserved. It provides equivalent performance. Now, when we are using RAP, we are not compromising on the performance or the quality of the pavement that we are going to construct with the use of RAP. We are going to have the same performance which we are going to have from the new pavement. So there is no difference in the performance of a recycled pavement or a new pavement. We can have the increased carbon credits, and this will also solve the problem of the safe disposal of the RAP material. When we're talking about the recycling, the different types of recycling, it can be done either hot recycling or it can be a cold recycling. Again, in hot recycling, we have hot in-place recycling or hot in-plant recycling. Similarly, in cold recycling, we have cold in-place recycling and cold in-plant recycling. Now, the basic difference or the fundamental difference between these types of recycling is, when we are talking about hot recycling, there we are using the hot materials at a higher temperature, and in place or in plant means in place I'm using the material at the same location in situ. I'm using the material in situ, and in plant means I'm taking the material to a plant wherein I am going to do the mixed design process. I'm going to mix new material and then I'm going to bring it back to the site and then I'm going to recycle it. Similarly, in the cold recycling, cold indicates the recycling and the milling and the recycling process done at the normal temperature. So heating is not used. And again, in situ means it is done, in place means it is done in situ, and in plant means it is taken to a site, to a cold mix plant, and then it is recycled. So the depth of recycling for different types of recycling, which is recommended as per the codal provisions, when you are going for the cold in situ recycling, it is the 75 mm of the total depth that can be recycled. For hot in situ, it is only the top layer, the top 50 mm that can be recycled. And when you are going with cold in plant and hot in plant recycling, it can be done up to 100 mm. Now what happens is sometimes even the base layers or the lower layers, not only the bituminous but the lower layers, they are also damaged. So in that case, we resort to something which is known as the full depth reclamation. Now, which type of recycling is to be adopted in what condition? For this, there is a chart which is given in the IRC 120, which is the codal provision for the recycling of the bituminous pavements. So it talks about the defects and deficiencies. And four different options are given, that like HIR is hot in place recycling, and CIR is hot in place recycling, and HIP and CIP is hot in plant recycling. So it talks about that if the severity defects, there are severity defects, but there are no structural deficiency, means the pavement is structurally sound, but there are only defects in the pavement. So you can go with the in situ recycling, either hot or cold. If they are, the defects are extending up to the bituminous basis, then you have to go with the in-plant recycling. Then in that case, because when it is going up to the basis, so the depth would be more than 100, more than 70 or 80 mm. So in that case, you have to go with the hot in-plant or cold in-plant recycling, depending upon what you prefer to choose. And when these defects are extending up to the granular basis, means even the lower layers, the granular layers, they're also defected, then in that case, you have to go with the cold in situ recycling. That is the full depth reclamation. So in the full depth reclamation, we go up to the granular layers also. And for the structural strength, if you're providing only a resurfacing, then you can go with the hot in situ or cold in situ. And if you're providing with overlay, then it has to be hot in plant and cold in plant recycling. So depending on this chart and the type of problem that you're facing, we can choose what type of recycling option can be adopted. Now we'll discuss about what is the difference between hot in situ, cold in situ, hot in plant, and cold in plant recycling. So hot in place recycling or hot in situ recycling, that is basically where we are using heaters to heat the existing wrap material and the existing binder. We scarify it, we add the missing aggregates, whatever is the missing aggregate, to finalize the gradation. If required, we can add some of the rejuvenating agent, and then it is repaved and compacted to the specified density. So here you can see there is these radiant heaters. Through the use of these radiant heaters, the pavement is heated and then it is scarified, milled. The material is again reused with some new aggregate fraction and new binder, and the material is repaved or relayed and compacted. So it's a big train that keeps on moving, and the entire function is done, entire process is done in situ. Means you scarify the material, take the milled material, add fresh material in the paver. Here you add the fresh material, relay it, and then you compact it. So it is all done in situ. Need not to take the material, scarified material, to a different site or to the plant. In hot in plant recycling, means you have to take the material to the hot mix plant location, where you have to stockpile it. You have to see that it is crushed and it is kept in the proper gradation. This process is known as fractionation. We'll talk about fractionation in some of the later slide. Then again, you mix with a virgin bitumen depending on the mix design, and then the fresh material is then taken back to the site and it is again relayed and compacted. So the difference here is this is all done in situ. The difference here is you take the material to the hot mix plant and there the process is carried out. Similarly, in the cold in place recycling, again you remove the scarif, you mill the existing surface. Here, since it is a cold in, it is a cold recycling, so either we can use the emulsion or we can use the foam bitumen plant. So because other we are not using any high temperature, so we are not heating the element, not heating the bitumen or the pavement. We are using it cold, so one has to use the emulsion or the foam bitumen. And the material is scarified. Again, it is mixed with the fresh material. You use the emulsion or the foam bitumen, relay it and repave it. So that is the cold in place recycling. And cold in plant is the material is taken to a site or taken to a hot mix plant where it is again mixed with the emulsion or foam bitumen, and then it is taken back to the site and it is again repaved. So here you have the stockpiling of the aggregates. This is the mixing of two different aggregates. Then you are transporting it to back to the site, the produced mix, and then it is unloaded to the paver and then it is laid. This is what the paving operation, and you compact it. So the difference between hot in place and in plant is in place is done on the site. It is in situ. It can be either hot or cold. And similarly, in plant is done when you take the material, milled material to the plant, and there the mix is produced. When you take the material to the plant, you have to stockpile the material. So the better is to cover the stockpile so that there is no moisture in the mix, and you have to fractionate. Means you should not mix two different traps. So fractionation is very important. We'll talk about fractionation, but moisture is important because you have to keep away the moisture because this affects the properties of the wrap mixture. Now, how to decide that what type of binder is to be used for the in the wrap mixtures? There are certain guidelines which recommend that if you are using wrap up to 15%, then there is no need to be no binder need to be changed. If you are increasing the wrap percentage, see, because wrap has a bitumen which is already hardened. So if you are increasing a higher percentage of wrap, which is between 15 to 24%, so the binder in the wrap is already hardened. And if you are using a virgin binder, so you might not get the desired property. So in that case, what it says that you choose a binder one grade lower than what you would otherwise use if you are using a higher percentage of wrap up to 25%. And if you are using wrap percentage more than 25, then you have to follow the blending charts. And the blending chart for the wrap bitumen, this is the blending chart which is given in the RC codes to determine the percentage of wrap. So here on the left y-axis, you'll see the viscosity of the recovered binder. And on the right side, this is the viscosity of the new asphalt, and the x-axis talks about the percentage of the weight of new asphalt. So here how we'll use this binder is from the wrap material we'll recover the binder, we'll extract the binder through the Epson recovery method, and then we'll find out the viscosity of this recovered binder. Suppose the viscosity of this binder, because this is a stiff binder, so the viscosity of this binder is going to be extremely high. So this is somewhere close to 1 × 10⁶ or somewhere in this range. So this is the point which indicates the viscosity of the recovered binder. Now I know what is the asphalt that I'm going to use in the preparation of the wrap mix. So I know the viscosity of the new asphalt or the rejuvenating agent. So this is the viscosity of the new asphalt that I'm going to use. So I draw a straight line joining these two points. Now this is the target viscosity of the final blend, which I need to identify. This is the target viscosity of the final blend. So once I have the target viscosity of the final blend, then I draw a horizontal line, and where this horizontal line cuts this diagonal line, Now, this is the percentage wherein I can identify like how much percentage of the fault is to be added. So from this, I can identify what is going to be the viscosity. So this is the blending chart. Now, as I told you, the maximum percentage that is allowed as per the Indian specifications is 30%. If you're using more than 30%, you have to add some rejuvenating agent or some kind of recycling agent to improve the properties. Now, the problems with more than 30% wrap is you'll face early cracking. The durability of surface layers would result in reveling. There is inconsistency of wrap because of the binder characteristics or because of the variation in the wrap gradation. And sometimes the restrictions of the voids and the voids and mineral aggregates, they also restrict the total amount of wrap. So the mixed design with more than 30% wrap can be an issue. So keeping those things in view, you have to restrict the total percentage of wrap up to 30%. Sometimes when the wrap is not properly fractionated or it is not stockpiled properly, then you have a huge, mountain of wrap wherein you have the wrap material from different sources. Now, such multiple source wraps are normally known as GOK piles, which is God only knows what's available there in the hump. So it can be an agglomeration of materials from different projects, pavement rubble or some rejected mix or hot mix plant waste. So it can be agglomeration of all those waste products also. And unprocessed GOK kind of wraps, they are not to be used because you have to do a proper fractionation wherein you have clear fractions of different gradations of wrap, which is like 99 down is stored here, between 99 to 4.75 is stored here, and down 4.75 is stored here. So you have different fractions of wrap, so proper fractionation is very important. So you have to screen the wrap, allow wrap to be used in different mixes, and you have to avoid crushing the wrap, otherwise you'll produce excessive fines, and which will not be good for the performance of the wrap mixes. Only the oversized wrap needs to be crushed and you have to store them separately. So fractionation is a very important aspect if you want to use the wrap in the bituminous mixes. The third important practice that I'm going to talk about is stabilized pavements. Now these days stabilization, I also talked about stabilization when we discussed that the problems we face. So one of the issue if you are facing is that the site is poor, so there you can actually stabilize the pavement. The stabilization can be done for all different layers, like for granular layer, the soil, or the bituminous layer. The different types of stabilization are mechanical stabilization, chemical stabilization, use of the conventional stabilizers, which are cement, lime, and fly ash, which are normally typically used for stabilizing the soil and the granular fractions. Excuse me. And these days we are also having commercial chemical stabilizers, which are known as CCS. They are basically the chemical compounds which can either be pre-mixed with the cement and or they have to be mixed with the cement at the site. So soil stabilization, we heard like stabilization provides a lot of advantages. It improves the strength, it reduces the volume change, improves workability, durability. And we can even use the marginal materials. It conserves resources, natural resources, and it also reduces the cost, provided like how economics work out. So you need to do a cost benefit analysis, like whether stabilization is cheaper or other methods are cheaper. Now, when we talk about the chemical stabilization, there are two different types of stabilizers. I told you one is the conventional stabilizer and the other is the commercial. Commercially available stabilizers, there are a number of them. Like in the conventional stabilizers, we have lime, cement, fly, bitumen, and other chemicals which can be used for stabilizing. And commercial stabilizers like RB81, then Stable Road, Terracell, Roadsem, Poly Roads, and many more. They are available, and these are all patented products. So we don't know much about their composition and what is the actual compound. But these can be used and they may result in a change in gradation, increase in workability, strength and durability, and reduction in the plasticity, and thereby improving the strength of the soil or the layer which you are stabilizing. So soil stabilization people have tried, but the more advantages can be obtained if you stabilize even the granular layers. So stabilizing the granular layers or use of the cementitious bases and subbases is a new concept, and this was introduced very recently in 2012 when IRC 37 provided for the use of cement treated bases and subbases in the bituminous pavements. When you're using with the cementitious bases and subbases, all types of aggregates, even the marginal aggregates can be used. We can even use the wrap material, industrial waste, CND waste. Obviously, you have to check for the properties of these waste. I mean, anything cannot be used. They have to have certain properties, some gradation requirements, and all types of soils with the PA less than 20 and PA less than 10 for bases. Now, the other requirements which needs to be fulfilled are, because we are using the commercially available stabilizers, so need to be checked for the presence of heavy metals, toxicity and leaching, because they sometimes leach out these heavy metals and they might be toxic to the groundwater. So you need to carry out the TCLP test, that is toxicity characteristics test. So one has to provide the TCLP test report if he is promoting his stabilizer for use in the road pavements. Also, these stabilizers should pass the durability test requirements. There is a IRC code which talks about the durability test requirement. There's a brushing test wherein we check the durability of the samples which are casted with the commercial available stabilizers or with the commercial stabilizers also. The third important point is when you are using these CTS stabilizers or the stabilized bases, you have to provide a crack relief layer on the top of the stabilized base layer. And this crack relief layer can either be in the form of an aggregate interlayer, or it can be in the form of a SAMI, which is a stress absorbing membrane interlayer. Now, what are these aggregate interlayer and SAMI? We'll talk about these layers. So options which I have for using these stabilized pavements is you can try all possible combinations, like stabilized bases with stabilized subbases, stabilized bases with granular subbases, and granular bases with stabilized subbases. The fourth option is obviously granular bases with granular subbases, which is not a stabilized pavement, so we have not discussed this. If you look at the stabilized bases with stabilized subbases, the structure of the pavement would look like this, wherein you have this. हेलो
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 मुकेश
हाँ जैसे देवर
प्लीज
सम डिस्टरबेंस
या
या सो माय बट माय माय वॉइस इज ऑडिबल ना
यस सर
ओके
सॉरी
ओके
फॉर इनकन्वीनियंस
नो दैट्स दैट्स ओके आई थॉट आई लॉस्ट द लिंक सो ओके सो व्हेन वी टॉक अबाउट द स्टेबलाइज्ड बेसिस विद स्टेबलाइज्ड सब बेसिस The structure would be something like this, wherein you have the subgrade. On the top of it, you have a CTSB layer, which is cement-treated or cementitious subbase. Then you have a cement-treated base. On the top of it, we have to provide this granular layer. Now, this granular layer is provided So this granular layer is provided on the top of CTB layer, because when you construct a CTB layer, it is going to have lot many shrinkage cracks. So to protect that the propagation of these shrinkage cracks on the top of the bituminous layer, if you place directly this bituminous layer directly on top of this CTB layer, then these shrinkage cracks would reflect exactly on the bituminous layer, and the bituminous layer would also get cracked. So to prevent the propagation of these cracks on the bituminous layer, we provide a aggregate relief layer, which is known as the crack relief layer. This can be either in the form of aggregate layer, or this can also be in the form of a This can either be in the form of a semi layer. Semi layer is basically nothing but it is an elastomeric bituminous binder is sprayed, and then you have a stone chipping on the top of it. So semi layer is this stress absorbing membrane interlayer. So either of these options are workable when you are having a CTB layer. Then the other option can be stabilized bases with granular subbases. Here you have the CTB layer. Now the bottommost layer is not stabilized. It is a conventional granular layer. Here also two options can be worked out. Like you have a CTB layer, on the top of it we have a GSB, we have a crack relief layer, or in place of a crack relief layer we can also have a semi layer. The third option is a granular bases with stabilized subbases. Now the structure for a granular basis with stabilized subbases is where we are not stabilizing the base layer, we are stabilizing only the subbase layer. The base layer is the conventional layer. So in this particular case, you do not require any kind of a crack relief layer or semi layer, because already the granular base layer is already provided. So any of these three options can be worked out. And for the design of these stabilized bases, just to give you a brief idea about how we do design. For the pavement design, we normally consider two different failures. One is the fatigue failure criteria and one is the rutting failure criteria. A pavement has to satisfy in both of these criteria. It has to be satisfied in the fatigue failure criteria, and it has to satisfy the rutting failure criteria. These two criteria are considered for the conventional pavements, but when you are using a stabilized bases and subbases, in that particular case, we have to also look for the failure of the cementitious layer. So one additional criteria that comes into play is the fatigue cracking of the cementitious layers. So that is also considered. And one more criteria, that is the cumulative fatigue damage, that will also be checked once when you are using the cementitious bases. So these two additional parameters need to be checked for the CFD analysis, that is the cumulative fatigue damage. We require the entire axle load spectrum that is expected to be plying on the pavement. And there is a different entire calculation, set of calculations that we do. But these are two additional parameters that you need to check when we are designing the pavements for these stabilized bases. So these are some of the pictures of stabilization on the site. This is the mixing of base material, polymer stabilization, stabilizer was sprayed, and then you do the pulverization, mixing, and then you compact it. Once the compact it is properly, then you can, after the BT layer is done, then you can provide the traffic movement on the finished layer. Now the advantage is why we go for the stabilized layer, and the advantage is that for one MSA traffic, this is one of the case study wherein if you provide the conventional pavement, you have to provide a thickness of this much, like this is 475 mm of thickness, 375 mm of thickness to be provided. But if you provide a cement treated base, in that particular case, it was shown that almost 40% of the aggregate saving was done. Other case study, we provided a design for our 20 MSA traffic, wherein for a conventional design, we moved to a stabilized design, and 25% thickness reduction was achieved. And this, when we worked out, it turned out to be approximately 118,000 tons of aggregates were saved with this 25% of the cost reduction. And this 118,000 tons, which was close to 4,000 truck trips and diesel requirements. So the amount of energy and the amount of material that is saved by moving to a much better or alternate design is substantial. So this is only for one pavement design. And you think that if you go for this alternate design, you can save substantial or huge quantities of material. So this will also be worked out to be cheaper material, and this is a better design also. Coming to the next practice, that is the warm mix asphalt. We are aware that conventionally we use the hot mix asphalt, wherein the mix is heated to a very high temperature of 145 to 160 degrees, and then you place it at a temperature of 135, and then you compact it at a temperature of 120 or 110. So that is a significant amount of energy is required to heat the mix, and obviously at the time of laying we substantially use a substantial amount of energy. So to reduce the energy, people started thinking that can we reduce the mix production temperatures, the temperature at which mix is produced in the hot mix plant, without compromising on performance. I don't want to compromise on the performance of the material that I'm getting, but is there a way, or is there a way out wherein I can reduce the property, I can reduce the temperatures at which the mix is produced? See, the problem with the bitumen is it is a viscoelastic material, so at a normal room temperature it behaves like a solid, and at a high temperature it behaves like a liquid. So to use bitumen, you have to basically heat the bitumen, otherwise it won't coat your bitumen particles, it won't coat your aggregate particles, you won't be able to produce a bituminous mix. So it's all about viscosity. So at high temperature the viscosity is low, so obviously it is able to coat the particles. So people started thinking, can we reduce, or can we play with the viscosity so that the kind of viscosity that I'm going to achieve at a high temperature, the same viscosity can be achieved at a lower temperature of 25 to 30 degrees lower, and I'm going to get the same quality of mix that I get at a higher temperature of 150 or 160 degrees. So people developed a lot many additives, and those additives form the broad category of warm mix asphalt. It is nothing but it's basically a hot mix asphalt wherein some additives have been used so that the mixing and production temperatures are reduced. So it is fundamentally not different from hot mix asphalt, and the production temperatures are 20 to 30 degrees centigrade lower. Now when I'm producing the mix at lower temperature, that indicates that I'm obviously consuming less amount of energy, less CO2 production is there, lower equipment wear is there, and a lot many benefits can be obtained when you have substantial reduction in the payment production temperatures. So CRI was the first, we did the experiment with the warm mix asphalt, and we laid the test section at the Bhavana in Delhi. This was done way back in 2009 or 10, and the road is still performing very good, and the temperatures were substantially lower. And since then, it has been applied to lot many other locations. One is the State Highway 5, Halol, Gujarat, Halol, Godhra, Gujarat, and Ringa Seeker Road. This warm mix additives were used, and warm mix asphalt was used. The Jammu bypass paving was done at a very low temperature of 1 to 2 degrees centigrade in night, and this could be laid easily. Laying of hot mix at such a low temperature is not recommended, and it is not neither even feasible, because when you bring the mix to the site, it will cool down rapidly and you won't get the compaction. But with VMA, but with the WMA, there were no such issues. Now, when you are using or producing the temperatures at a lower temperature, then obviously there are benefits of the mixing temperature. So here you see that the mixing temperature is 170 to 180 for the hot mix, and for warm mix asphalt it was only 120 to 130. So it was observed during plant operation that the savings were approximately 20 to 25% of fuel savings were there in the cost of WMA. So substantial cost reduction in the consumption of fuel. Even since the temperature, production temperatures are lower, it is expected that the emissions from the asphalt mix would also be lower, and that was also substantiated with the observations. And it also says that the production of these emissions, it was substantially lower compared to the hot mix asphalt. If you see the production of CO2 was close to 46% lower than the conventional hot mix asphalt. Fuel consumption was almost 55% lower, and NOx was 58% lower, SO2 was 81%, and carbon monoxide was 63%. So all emissions were reduced, and this is one of the other advantage of using a warm mix of fluid. So the last one that I'm going to discuss is the perpetual or long life payments. See, normally we design a payment for 20 or 15 or 20 years of design life. What if I can design a payment which is perpetual? Let me clarify that there is nothing which is perpetual. Perpetual, if you look at the dictionary meaning of perpetual, the dictionary meaning of perpetual is something which lasts forever. But since payment is a civil engineering structure and there cannot be any structure which lasts forever, so payments are designed to fail. They have to perform a function for a particular period of time. They have to satisfy their design life or they have to satisfy the design traffic, and only then they are allowed to fail. So if a payment is designed for a traffic of 100 MSA, so it will fail only after it caters to a traffic of 100 MSA. If it is designed for a design life of 15 years, so it will fail only after design, after it completes the design life of 15 years. So payments are designed to fail. You cannot design a payment which is perpetual, which lasts forever. Because the materials that we use in the payment, they are temporary susceptible, they are the environment susceptible. So the materials will degrade and ultimately the payments will fail. So perpetual word in sense is a misnomer. So the right terminology to be used is the long life payments. We can increase the design life of the payment. We can design a payment for a design life of 50 years or 60 years. Traditionally, we design for a design life of 15 to 20 years. But if we can increase the design life for 50 to 60 years, so those payments are called as perpetual payments. The correct terminology is the long life payments. Now, how this would happen that I can design a payment for 50 years of design life? Now, the concept is if you provide, I told you that we design payment for two different failures. One is the fatigue cracking and one is the rutting cracking. One is the rutting. So if I can somehow control the rutting and fatigue such that there is no cracking in the bituminous layer and there's no rutting in the payment structure, even in the 50 years of design life, and I'll only scarify the top portion of the bituminous material and I'll repay it, I'll relay it with a new bituminous material. So that way I can achieve something which is perpetual. So what it says that if you can control, we can provide that payment design in such a way that the tensile strain at the bottom of bituminous layer is less than controlled to a value of my 80 microstrain, the bituminous layer will never crack because this is lower than the endurance limit of the bituminous payment. Similarly, the vertical separated strain, if I keep it to a value below 200 microstrains, there will not be any rutting in the subgrade. So I design the payment in such a way that the tensile strain and vertical strain remain below these values, and the different layers are so designed that only the surface layers would need to be scarified or it need to be replaced from time to time, and I can simply remove it, I can simply relay it. So that is the concept of the perpetual payment. We discussed about some of the paying practices, but it is not that only these paying practices, they have also been promoted by the ministry, and ministry also recommends that these new technologies should be used in different projects. So there is a recent circular from the ministry, though there have been continuous ministry of Road Transport and Highways has been releasing circulars and updates for the promotion of new technology, but this the recent one circular, they came out with a circular in December 2020, wherein they said that the subject is use of new and alternative material and technology in the construction of highways. And the different technology they have specified is the CTB bases, CTB subbase, then the use of waste plastic, then the recycling in highway construction. So it is necessary to promote these technology in the construction and maintenance of national highways. So ministry is also promoting the use of these new technologies. So if we adopt to these new technologies, obviously we can build better highways, we can build sustainable payments which will last longer, and with the concept of sustainability, we are not depriving our future generations of their benefits or their rights. So with this, I'll end my presentation. Thank you from my side. If you have any queries, any questions, I would be happy to answer. Over to you, Darshan.
So, whether any questions from the participants?